See, you are what you are in this world. That's either one of two things. Either you're somebody, or you're nobody.
A lot of this is behind the scenes or under the hood.
It's time to just look under the hood. No stone should be unturned.
I don't even know what that means. Look under, I got an engine underneath my hood.
Most important thing in business is honesty. Integrity, hard work. Family. Never forgetting where we came from.
Hey, pop the hood.
Pop the hood?
Pop the hood.
Welcome to the Under the Hood podcast with Jonathan Hood.
Uh-huh.
Zora in her room?
Oh, Michelle, let me call you back, okay? Yeah, what's up?
She stole that money.
Oh, baby, come here. Go in the living room, okay? Go ahead, go sit down.
Zora!
What?
Zora, open this door!
Jacob, don't do this.
Didn't we tell her not to lock this door?
We did. Okay.
Open the door!
What do you guys want?
Where's the money?
What money? Zora. Wait, no. Stop, can you please stop going through my stuff?
Zora, just tell the truth. Did you take the money out of the offering?
I don't know what you're talking about. I didn't take any money.
Did you take the money?
Can you please stop going through my stuff? I don't know what you're talking about. I didn't take any money. I didn't take any money.
Please.
Please stop going through my stuff.
Where is it? Huh? Where is it?
Jacob!
What'd I tell you? What'd I tell you? Lie to me. Hey,
welcome to the Under the Hood podcast with me, Jonathan Hood. Don't forget to follow me on Twitter, twitter.com, tweetjhood. Also, my Facebook page, facebook.com, and also on Instagram, igjhood. We have a very special guest, as always, here on the Under the Hood podcast. It's Lamman Rucker. You know the name? Lamman Rucker is an actor. He plays Pastor Greenleaf in the show Greenleaf that's on the Oprah Network, on the OWN Oprah Network. It's a terrific show that my family and I watch. If you are interested in a show that continues to unravel so many different layers of the church, good and bad, I think that you could be interested in Greenleaf. It takes place on the OWN Network. It airs every Wednesday night, and again, you can go to oprah.com and check out the season. Right now, Greenleaf is in season number 3, so I hope that you get a chance to watch the show, because it's a show that I'm a big fan of. And Lamman Rucker has played on As the World Turns and All My Children as someone that was in soap operas. He's been in Tyler Perry films, Why Did I Get Married and Why Did I Get Married 2, Meet the Browns. And now he's part of Greenleaf as one of the pastors on this program. I'm a big fan of Jacob Greenleaf because he's a man that is trying to find himself away from his dad. Keith David, by the way, is a terrific actor as well. And he's the main character, one of the main characters on the show. But you know, Lamman Rucker is Jacob Greenleaf on the show, and he's trying to find his way. Trying to find his way through a very difficult marriage and trying to be a great father. And I think the story is very compelling on Greenleaf. So check that out on the OWN Network. I talked to Lamman about his career, talking about how life is for him professionally, how he was able to get involved with Greenleaf after being on so many different roles, especially in soap operas, and now being able to be one of the main characters on the show Greenleaf. We also talk about his love for the Pittsburgh Steelers, because he's a big Steelers fan being out of Pittsburgh. We also discuss about how people refer to him as Pastor Greenleaf, even though his name is Lamman Rucker, clearly, and he's been around acting going back to the late 90s. So it's an interesting journey as we talk to Lamman Rucker, the actor from the hit TV show Greenleaf on the OWN Network. He's with us on the Under the Hood podcast. Lamman, Jonathan Hood, thanks so much for your time.
Hey, man, thank you for having me, bro.
How's life for you professionally right now?
Life is good. God is good. You know, staying busy. As I like to say, staying busy and staying out of trouble. So, can't complain about that at all, man. Just keeping it moving. Busy. And, you know, rolling on season 3 of Greenleaf right now. So, things are going exceptionally well.
Yeah, my family is a really big fan of this show. I want to find out how you were approached to be considered for this role and being cast at Greenleaf. What was that process like for you?
It was, you know, actually pretty standard for me, man. No real bells and whistles about the process, you know, actually. So I think a lot of people think that part is typically pretty exciting. But no, man, just like, at least from my perspective, it was just like any other actor who gets access to, you know, auditioning for the role. You audition, and then you kind of go through the process of auditioning, you know, through, you know, for a couple different people. And then at some point you get signed off on, like, yeah, we want this guy, you know. Mm-hmm. So then it's kind of got to go up the line after the producers sign off on you. Then the network and the studio have to do the same, and the deal is done. But so it actually happened fairly quickly for me, though. I actually thought that this might have been a job that I was going to potentially miss out on, to be honest with you. So for a couple of different reasons. One, my schedule at the time was hindering me from auditioning for it when I had the first, you know, opportunity to have an audition schedule. And then even after that, and at that point, I was kind of looking at the character description and thinking about the project, and I was like, I don't know. Is this, you know, this the kind of thing I want to do a show about? You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Right?
And not only that, like, am I the right guy for this character? I doubt that I'm the type of guy and I'm the actor that they'd be looking for, you know? So there were a couple different reasons why I was a little unsure about whether or not it would even happen for me, right?
Right.
Whether that was my decision or theirs, and as fate would have it, you know, and which is why I also use it as a real lesson for many people. Don't be in your own way, you know, and always just give it a shot. Go for it. Make strong choices about what your interpretation of a role is going to be, and then go in there and, you know, and swing, you know, and leave the rest of it to the decision makers, and also leave your fate to the man upstairs, and just do your part and keep it moving. And as you see, things worked out quite well for me and for us as a team, you know what I mean? So mm-hmm. We ended up putting some really, really incredible pieces together. It's an incredible cast. People I love to work with, people who that I actually even like, right? It's always good to work with people you like and that you come to care about. And some of these folks I've already known, already knew Keith and Lynn. So that was great to already have a little bit of a rapport and a dynamic with some folks that you already have experience with and whose work, you know, you respect. So it's been a great opportunity, and, you know, but it came to me pretty standardly, and you know, you just do your thing and keep marching through all these different steps, and hope that you get that, you know, get that call. And like I said, that it's those sign-offs and those thumbs up and check, you know? So luckily,
right.
They said check, Oprah said check, you know what I'm saying? And here we are.
Check out season 3 of Greenleaf. Again, go to oprah.com. You can see it for yourself, download it. If you are behind, start with season 1 and catch up right now like we are right now in our household. Season 3 at oprah.com. Lamman, how many people do you run into that refer to you as Pastor Greenleaf for Jacob?
Oh, come on, man. I mean, every day. It's incredible. I mean, even to the point where I think I'm getting off the plane, and even as you're getting off the plane, you know, and as people are getting on the plane and they're passing you, they're like, you know, sometimes that's all you see. You just look up and somebody's mouth is wide open, or they're pointing at you, or, you know, that type of thing. So, I mean, every step of the way, it doesn't matter. I mean, you can be in the car and then the driver's, you know, looking up in the rearview mirror and it's just like, hey, you know, you know, you're trying to get your bags and the whether it's security or, you know, other employees or other travelers or whatever. I mean, this is just literally, this is just airport, right, in type of environment that we're talking about. Every step of the way, people stop me multiple times, every day, everywhere, male and female, all kind of different, you know, colors and creeds. I mean, this the impact of this show and the fan base is so wide and so broad, you know, there's so much love and appreciation for what we're doing. It's incredible. And tons of people are Lamman Rucker fans, which I appreciate. And a lot of people really dig what's happening with Jacob and really understand and are identifying with his journey and you know, his struggles. And at the same time, all the great things they see, you know, in Jacob. So it touches a lot of people. It speaks to a lot of people. Sometimes, you know, folks literally will punch me, you know, because they're like, get it together, Jacob. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, the guys rolling up on me all the time, and they're just like, yo, man, you're like, your wife, bro? You know? Or like, man, your sister? And I'm like, which one? You know? So even, I mean, whatever it is. And again, of course, these women are more than just beautiful women. But, you know, just some of the other random things that people will say, they'll come up to me and they're not even asking me questions about me. And they're like, you need to get your daughter under control, you know. Right. Or tell Bishop I said hi. You know, I love me some Lady May. Or whatever it is, you're always getting comments, you know, and all kind of stuff coming from different directions about, you know, about not even just Jacob, but so many of the other threads and the other people within the family and the dynamics that we have. So it's a lot of fun. Sometimes people's timing is, you know, it can be the worst. You know, trying to eat and they're coming over, tapping you on the shoulder, trying to ask you for a picture, you know. But overall, you know, people are really, really incredible and, you know, extremely supportive of what we're doing. You know, thought there was going to be a lot of pushback. I think a lot of people were afraid that we were really, that we were going to be in the business of causing problems, you know, so to speak, and disrespecting the church. But that's not at all what our intent is and what we've been doing, and not at all what the majority of people, I can't even recall anybody who said, you know, y'all need to stop doing the show. If anything, even throughout the faith community, faith leaders, tons of people who consider themselves preachers' kids, they're like, y'all are nailing it. You know, this is great. We'd love it. You know, we can't get enough. People are more upset with me about us not having more episodes, not being on TV longer, and having to wait what they consider so long for Greenleaf to come back. You know, like that's right. The negative that we get, and that's the gist of it. That's the most of it. Other than that, it's all love. So it's been a great, great ride and incredible feedback, you know.
Yeah, well, Lamana, what I find interesting about what you're saying is that when I talked to Joseph Sikora from Tommy from Power, or Shanola Hampton, who I just talked to about Shameless, it's funny how people will try to resonate with the character and talk to the character more so than the person. So clearly, you know, when Joseph Sikora walks around and he's referred to as Tommy, he does turn around and interact. So you don't mind that, obviously, because clearly there's a lot of popularity with this show when someone can just randomly come up to you and call you Pastor. You're totally fine with that.
Well, I'll have to admit 100% that I'm not totally fine with it 100%. So sometimes I'll turn around and I'll remind people, I'll say, it's Lamont, but how you doing? You know, or sometimes I just, smile and keep walking. I mean, it all varies, but sometimes, folks for the most part mean well, and then there's other times where literally, you've got to sometimes help people with their manners, for lack of a better way to put it. You know what I mean?
Right.
When you know they don't know you, sometimes they just might not be able to recall your name, and they see you, and, it's just out of excitement. But it varies, and to be completely honest with you, sometimes it varies with me relative to, it's not that I'm not okay with it. Sometimes it's just like, hey, all right, great, yep, that's right. But then there's several names that people have, so I'll be in a completely different frame of mind, a completely different thought, and people are calling me, they're like Temptations, or they're calling you, one of my names from the soaps, or they're calling you, Troy or Will, I'm literally not walking around expecting to hear 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different names. My name's Lamman. It's just me. I'm just chilling, walking around in my own life. I don't see myself as a celebrity. I don't expect people to notice me, all these things. So I'm not. So when somebody says pastor, they could be talking to anybody, sometimes it's obvious and it's relevant, and it's pretty clear that they're talking to me and they're trying to get my attention. Everybody doesn't always do it in the most courteous way. Sometimes they're aware of it. They don't really care. Sometimes they, like I said, they're just excited and beside themselves. And, and it's all good. And you just kind of learn how to, my real name is,
Right.
And I'm here with, and then they're like, oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, hello, and hello to you and you and you. And then, So sometimes it can be a little uncomfortable. And I don't really care to have that much attention brought to myself. I think there's other people who, who really bask in the attention. They hope to get it, and they can't wait for somebody to, make a scene. But, I'm significantly more humble and laid back than that. That's not kind of really, my style. You know what I mean? But,
right, I understand.
So it definitely doesn't offend me, because I'm glad that people are so connected to what we're doing. And when you're in someone's home as often, right, as I'm in their home, as these different people or as these different characters, you totally understand why people have a connection to you and sometimes why they feel so familiar, and then even sometimes why they don't expect to ever see you. You got to remember, people see you on the screen, they never expect to see you in real life, So then once they do, it's just like, they lose their minds. So it's crazy. I take it for granted because I'm just me, and I'm walking around in my own skin all the time, and this is what I do. But other folks, like I said, really get beside themselves sometimes when they see you. And sometimes you just got to help reel them back in.
Right.
They'll be screaming, and then you have to kind of help me, like, okay, we're going to talk in this voice right here. I need to ask you just to kind of dial that volume down just a little bit. it's always an adventure, man, that's for sure.
Catch Lamman Rucker.
Hands down, always appreciative. Gratitude, 100%.
Catch Lamman Rucker on Greenleaf. Again, go to oprah.com, and we're in season 3 right now. You can watch it right there on oprah.com. I think that when we talk about being a father and being able to raise children, I think one of the things that resonates with a lot of, especially men, is the way that your character is raising your daughter. You're going through some really tough times now as she grows up. Were, or are you, as far as your parents are concerned, were they as tough on you as you are on your daughter on Greenleaf?
Oh, yeah, if not tougher, which is one of the things I try to bring to Jacob and to this whole Greenleaf, family. I actually consider Jacob's childhood to have been more strict than mine. Mm-hmm. So, which is one of the things that I think is actually a challenge for him, is that he's, you know, I think as we all do, we all have sometimes very mixed feelings about even the way we were raised, right? Believe it or not, even folks that weren't raised with strict parents, you know, even throughout my experience as a teacher, you actually, it's really interesting to learn how resentful many young people are that their parents didn't give them structure, right? Although we're very accustomed to the concept of a child that has a lot of structure being rebellious and mischievous and irresponsible and bucking back against that structure, right? So, you know, if you think about the fact that, I mean, just look at the way Bishop and Lady May, you know, are, right? I mean, they're very, very conservative, very poised, very drawn up. I mean, we come from a very intelligent, formal, sophisticated family. And, you know, I see Jacob and Grace and Charity and Faith's childhood as one that all that had, you know, where we were taught etiquette and we had to do the very, you know, formal and traditional things. I mean, you know, you see our daughters and my sisters and talking about being at cotillions, right? I mean, that's the type of cultural landscape that we were also, you know, raised in. Not to mention, as some people know, when it comes to the real structure and formality of being in the church, let alone actually be the first family, right? Mm-hmm. There's a whole other kind of rigidity and formality and all this kind of stuff you've got to do. So I'm trying not to do some of that, you know, as Jacob with Zora and Winky, because, you know, Jacob has issues with some of the, you know, some of those things. He sees how some of that stuff wasn't really good for him and good for his childhood and for their family. At the same time, he also sees and understands how important many elements of that are. So I can definitely parallel that to my own family. I mean, I had the privilege of being in what I consider a fairly balanced environment where, of course, we all knew very clearly what things my parents, right, absolutely were not going to tolerate. And it wasn't just my parents. It was the extended family. It's your grandparents, your aunts, your uncles. It's, you know, the whole village community dynamic. There was stuff that I knew, even if my parents weren't around, I still couldn't get away with it, you know, because somebody else was looking, you know, or watching over you or looking out for you or whatever. So that's how we all try to be on the show. I try to be just as firm with Sophia as I am with Zora, you know, just as firm with my son as I am with my daughter and vice versa. But, you know, Jacob's also a very, like I said, a different person than me. So I try to figure out what the ways are based on who he is as a person that's very different than who Lamman is as a person, and how he might navigate being a father and being a husband that's different than how Lamman, you know, would do that. But naturally, there are a lot of similarities. So, I mean, that's the fun of being an actor, is that I get to live in the lives and in the skin and bones of somebody who, you know, is like, you know, like we literally get like 9 lives, or we get 100 lives. You know, we get to live experiences, even if only for a certain amount of time, that are very different than ours. And it's really cool. Like, oh, okay, so this is what it feels like to be, you know, wealthy. this is what it feels like to be, you know, privileged, or to be a family of power. And, you know, almost like a royal, you know, like I consider us almost like we're like a royal family. Oh, okay, this is what that is like. This is what, you know, formal dinners in a dining room and having help and having this huge mansion. Like, I don't live like that. I've never lived like that. But I get the opportunity to live like that, in a sense, through this character. And it informs everything that you do as this character, from the way you walk, talk, the way you raise your children, and everything. So it's very similar to Jacob in some ways, but in most ways, very, very different. Like Jacob definitely, at least initially, let Zora get away with a lot more than Lamar would have, because definitely the way I was raised, male or female, certain things, you know, we don't play that. But we all try to do that as a cast, because of the way we all are as people, we have the commonality of like, black folks don't do that, you know, kind of general thing, which is something we joke about at work. at the same time, we all come from very different places and very different people and very different constructs. And we don't always agree on everything, even individually. I mean, Kim Hawthorne and I, who plays Carissa, we were always discussing and debating, you know, what we would do or what we should do and how much differently Carissa and Jacob might do something that's different than the way I parent and maybe very different than the way Kim parents. You know, she has two teenage boys, as a matter of fact. She doesn't have daughters. So the way she deals with, has to try to figure out how to deal with Zora as Carissa, she doesn't necessarily have the same landscape for, you know. But my earliest parenting experience, you know, as even as a teenager, was just as an uncle and a godfather. And the first four children were girls, you know. Mm-hmm. So I've had a lot more hands-on experience raising girls probably than she has. You know what I mean? So that all informs how we do our work, as well as the way we raise ourselves as children.
Well, if I misplace something, for sure, I'm going to ask you, because you found $100 like in 3 minutes, just like that. If I'm missing something, I'm gonna bring you in, because you'll be able to find it right away, like that stolen $100 on that show. It didn't take you long, man, to rattle some cages and find that $100. That for sure. Let me ask you this, Lamont. When it comes to soap operas, what was that experience like? Because, you know, as you see now in 2018, the you're not getting as many soap operas, at least daytime soaps, as it was, say, 10, 20 years ago. What was that experience like being part of a daily soap opera?
Man, I loved it, actually. It was very intimidating at first, and I think as you're coming into that space of being in daytime TV, you know, I also remember the stigma that was kind of connected to soaps. People were like, you know, I mean, there's some folks who were, I mean, devoted, devout, you know, to soap operas, and then there's others who would kind of look down on it, like, you know, they can't act, or that they're overdramatic, or they're just, you know, they got some pretty people, but, you know, they're not really talented, you know? And there's these other things that are kind of sometimes implied within the industry, where people kind of look at, you know, maybe real grassroots theater, right, as maybe kind of the bottom rung. And that's what you do when, you know, nobody knows your name and you don't really get paid for it. There might only be 10 people in the audience or whatever, right? And then you kind of work your way up to, you know, to doing something else. It's kind of like this weird, like, kind of hierarchy and what people think. But doing television soap operas, I think for many people, they consider that like the bottom rung of television. You know what I'm saying? Just like they consider certain things the bottom rung of theater, and maybe in film they're like, oh, what's that? Just like some short film with, you know, it only took you $500 to make, like, oh, who cares about that? You know, there's these things that people have about how they kind of look down on certain work. And I'm glad that I didn't have that, like, because I come from the theater, for one. I understand the value of all work, of all mediums, and I know there's talented people everywhere. I also know that, especially in New York, where As the World Turns is, there's so many great actors, and many of them are excellent theater actors, and many of those strong and well-trained theater actors also work in daytime. One of the reasons why people sometimes think, oh, they're overacting and it's melodramatic, well, that's a style, you know what I mean? And that's what people don't understand, is all of these different genres and all these different mediums have been stylized in slightly different ways, and sometimes very different ways. So soap operas were initially on the radio, you know, and when that transition happened from radio to television, the stylization and the melodrama and all that, I mean, they're called operas nicknamed soap operas, for God's sake. And that's why, is they have a particular style to them. And once you understand what that style is and what that nuance is, and you understand how much work there is to tackle at one time. I mean, my first week, my first couple of days on As the World Turns, I literally had like 15 pages a day, a couple days in a row.
Wow.
And this is my first time on daytime television. The first time I've got a lead principal contract role, and I'm coming into a show where I'm the newbie, I'm the rookie, and I'm coming onto a show where there's people who've been there like 20, 30 years, you know?
Right.
And I'm in the scene with them. I mean, I come on the show, and I'm representing one of the queens of the show, you know? Like, it's like you can't come in there and not know what you're doing and not be prepared and not be confident and not know your stuff, you know, And but it was intimidating. I have to admit, I was definitely intimidated. I was definitely, you know, you naturally have your doubts about whether you can do it, whether you can cut it. But you also have to believe, absolutely, I can do this, and I'm going to come in here, do my thing, and knock this out. And I was only supposed to be there a couple months, and then they ended up offering me a 3-year contract as Marshall Travers on As the World Turns. So it was really tough, and I had a lot to do, especially up front. But again, a hell of a training ground, and luckily I came in there with some strong training from high school and college, you know, being accustomed actually to doing a lot of work at the same time. And I'm used to doing multiple, you know, jobs at the same time. So for me to now, all I got to do is focus on this one thing, this one character, this one job. I don't have to do a play over here, this over here, and another thing over there all at the same time. You know, like, I've been there. I've had to do one-act plays, for example, that I had literally 3-4 days to prepare for, and then you're up in full production in 3-4 days or maybe a week. So I luckily had that kind of, like I said, teaching and training and discipline under me already. Now that was my opportunity to, you know, to really put it all to work and, you know, and to see what you're made of, you know. So, and I had other opportunities prior to that, but that was definitely the first time at that level, national television, you know, as somebody who was going to be at the center of the storyline of, you know, one of the most legendary daytime shows of all time. It was tough, and unfortunately that show's gone, and it shouldn't be, but we're losing those old soap operas, because now we've got reality shows and all this other stuff, which I think are now our current day soap operas. I mean, you got these little girls fighting at Fashion Week. I mean, come on. That's something you used to see on a soap opera. I mean, you know what I'm saying? And it's scary. Yeah, but I'm actually embarrassed. But that's where we are now.
But Lamont, here's the thing about reality television is that it seems circular. It seems like it's the same plot. I could watch a 30-minute show, like, you know, again, it could be any of these shows on any channel. It just seems like that there is a start of it. There is contrived conversation. There's always a hook at the end where there's a fight or something like that, and you got to wait for next week. I mean, the formula clearly works because it still exists on television, but there's nothing really new to it. And I guess that's the secret in the sauce, right?
I agree with you, but the unfortunate thing is, even though there's nothing really new to it, you know, people can't get enough of it. They want to come back to the same foolishness with the same old people over and over and over again. And then all they do is make sure they find some different people that, again, have their own version of same foolishness. So every time you turn around, now there's something else. There's something else. There's something else. I mean, there are some actually really valuable, you know, non-scripted programs that are out there. But at the same time, unfortunately, a lot of things that also fall under that category are really just people acting a fool and setting a terrible example for all of us of what, you know, being on this planet is all about. But I think those are our current day soap operas now. So many of the dynamics that you used to get in a more controlled environment and that was supposed to just be kind of, you know, applied to specific people, specific characters, and a specific type of reality. Now that reality has been expanded into real life reality. But again, even a lot of that is contrived. You know, you're getting these reality shows with these, you know, these, you can't even call them actors, with these people, you know, that are, you know, being put in certain situations. Many of them, they don't even have control over, you know. So they're being exploited, you know, in a very, very unhealthy way. At the same time, they're willingly exploiting themselves, most folks, they just, you know, they want the attention, they want the fame, they want this, they want that, who knows, they need the money, but, you know, they're really putting themselves in a bad spot and setting a horrible example for our young people. You know, that's my opinion. And, you know, before, I don't remember that many young people watching soap operas. If you did, you were watching them with your grandparents or something right. like that, you know, or you were watching them over the summer when because you were sleeping in late a little bit, you turned on the TV and that's pretty much all that's on up until, you know, 1 or 2 o'clock, you know? But other than that, you know, it kind of wasn't really, you know, I don't remember having that kind of impact on how we saw the world when I was young, you know, but nowadays, if I didn't know any better, I would, you know, what examples would I have to follow, you know? And that's why doing Greenleaf is also so important to me and to us, is to show, even though we're imperfect too, and even though it's drama, and some might say it might fall into certain stereotypes or archetypes too, we're actually just trying to show real people who are principled, people who are spiritual, who are people of God, who love each other, who support each other, who are actually working to do their best, not at every turn, you know, working to do their worst or bring the worst out of, you know, out of someone else. So we're trying to counter some of the other narratives that are out there as best we can. So, you know, we'll keep fighting the good fight and see where we land.
Jonathan Hood with Lamman Rucker from Greenleaf. You can go to oprah.com and check out the episodes of Greenleaf. They're in season 3 right now. I'm following along old school week to week because I believe in the episodic feel for a television show. So again, check out season 3. It's on right now on the OWN network. So I want to ask you about Oprah. You know, you have no other choice but to be proud of her success. People thought that after a talk show that was going to be a wrap for Oprah because she's not on a daily talk show. But the thing that I really like about the OWN network, Lamont, is that you take a look at the budding television network that she's put on, the Have and Have Nots, watching Greenleaf, Miss Van Zandt and her shows on Saturdays. I think that Oprah has done a really good job in her post-talk career to be able to put together this network because there's a lot of quality shows. What's it like to work with her?
Oh, I mean, and the fact that she's also on our show has been like an awesome, you know, added privilege. But and I can call her auntie. I mean, you know, that's kind of dope. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
But but just aside from obviously just Oprah, right? This Oprah factor. I mean, this global icon that this woman is that has its own impact. I mean, it's almost surreal that I get to have this opportunity, not just to tell this incredible story about this great family and this great man, Jacob Greenleaf, but the fact that it's with her and under her supervision, under her advisement, and we've got her love, her support. I mean, she's, you know, at the core of what we do. I mean, you know, she's got to be okay with the stuff that happens or it doesn't happen, you know. And even that, just to be in a position to where, you know, my boss is a black woman, you know what I mean? I mean, all these things are very profound and, you know, to me about working with her and working for her. And what I believe she's trying to do with this network, what I understand her goals are with this show and the other original programming that's come after us, and even some of the other stuff, like you said, some of the non-scripted stuff, the other, you know, spiritual programs and self-help stuff that she has on there all the time, her distributing Tyler Perry stuff over the last few years as well. You mentioned the Have-Nots and a couple other things. So the Tyler Perry stuff is a very different world than ours. However, all this stuff collectively is about people, again, us as African-American people, seeing ourselves, you know, on TV, being able to tell our stories. You know, even Queen Sugar had all female directors on all of its episodes. You know, we've got all kind of diversity throughout our, you know, the directors that we have, which is part of what we strive to do on our show. So each show even has its different, like, themes and has its different objectives that are all aligned with the kind of world we all want to be in, you know, that where our perspectives and our stories and our hearts and our truths are being honored and prioritized. And yet we know we're not on this planet by ourselves, right? We've got to allow other people into the framework of our lives and of our stories. We've got to push our women forward and lift them up the way they deserve to be. You know, we see some really wonderful, powerful, sensitive, compassionate, intelligent, brilliant Black men throughout, you know, her shows as well. You know, people trying to make it work, trying to put family first and God first and love first, you know. Even our third show, right? Love Is. It's like, you know, it's like all this stuff that's really about, you know, how do we figure out, you know, the best way to get it right, and hey, let's figure out how to do it right together. You know, in all these shows, that's what it's about. It's about family, it's about faith, and it's about, you know, it's about love. And that really is, you know, that might be her wrapped, you know, wrapped in the one. But who is it that, you know, a description of, right? I mean, we're all that. In simplicity, we all want just the really basic, meaningful, fundamental things about life and what it is to be human and what it is to be a child of God wherever we are. And I really think that that's what speaks to most of us, if not all of us, that work with her and work for her. So to be able to be in that kind of a place where you know that your boss has your back, you know, I mean, hey, how many people even are in that kind of environment, right?
Right.
Not to mention to be working for an organization where you got your boss's back, you know? I mean, you know good and well. I mean, let's just keep it real. I mean, I'm not going to go too far on this whole other tangent, but even when we're talking about, right, and professional athletics, I mean, how much more profound would we be as a country, as a society, even as a game, even if we were just to focus on football, but even, you know, the other athletes who have been vocal about their activism or vocal about their faith or vocal about their sexuality or whatever, and whatever sport that they played or whatever other industry they were in, I mean, what kind of volumes did it speak? And think about the amount of incredible impact that can happen or has happened when that athlete is in alignment with his coach, his, you know, the management or even the owner of the organization that he's, you know, that he's playing for, you know, and very seldom is that the case. Instead, we got all this friction, especially in the NFL. The owners do not have their players' backs, you know. They're worried about those advertising dollars. They're worried about they're more in aligned with their, you know, political allegiance than they are about the principle of what their athletes, you know, are standing for, or they're standing for something by kneeling for something, right?
Right.
But, like, imagine how incredibly powerful they would be as a unified force if the boss and the players were on the same page, you know? And I'm privileged to be in an environment where we're all fighting for the same things, and we got each other's backs. And it's really too bad that other people in other places don't have the same.
Lamman, a couple of more for you, and I appreciate your time as always. Growing up in Pittsburgh, were you a Steelers guy? Who was your football team growing up?
All day, baby, hands down. Ain't no other conversation in the world.
nice tie against Cleveland on Sunday.
Oh, it broke my heart. But you know what? I mean, that's the thing. I can be a diehard Steelers fan, and at the same time recognize that some good things are starting to happen in Cleveland, which I actually appreciate. I mean, it ain't no fun to just wallop people every time you play them. That's not where I come from, you know? I'm not one of them dudes that runs to the best team in the league to try to play for them, you know, so that you have decisive wins over everybody you play. I'd rather have competitive games every time you play. So even when Cleveland doesn't necessarily do well as a team or throughout a particular season, when Cleveland plays the Steelers, it's always a game. It's always a problem. Everybody's coming for you when you're, you know, when you got that black and gold on. So you gotta come with it. And that division has always been one of the most competitive and had some of the most parity throughout, you know, its history. I mean, other divisions, you already know who's coming out on top because they just run through everybody and the odds are stacked and, you know, and many teams' favor. So it's actually good to see Cleveland kind of coming around. I mean, I don't like to watch other people fail. I always prefer to beat you, but but I always want to have a fair fight. So I love the fact that they're starting to do some good things over there. And again, I'm all good with power shifts and stuff like that. You're not always going to be in first place. You're not always going to be at the top of the pile. There's somebody else who's going to come along. And they're going to start, you know, kicking your butt, you know, and then you got to earn your way back to the top. So it would actually be nice, as much as I hate to have these words come out of my mouth as a Pittsburgh boy, you know, it'd be actually nice to see the city of Cleveland get themselves, you know, some success over there. I was thrilled when that happened, you know, during LeBron's time there, honestly. I mean, I think the Cleveland Indians, you know, were finally getting their act together for a minute and looked like they would be in that conversation for a while and then they'd be back. So I think that's kind of cool. So that tie, definitely, I would have much rather had been 24-21. You know, I saw Boswell miss that field goal.
Right.
Yeah, you know, I'll take it for now. At least we didn't take an L. You know what I mean? I'd much rather have a tie than an L, but I'd much rather have a win than anything else. But that's, we're going to play them, you know, at least one more time, probably two. So I'm looking forward to the next time. But I see they got Josh Gordon back in there. They got a couple other pieces in there now where they're getting it together. That's not going to be an easy trip. You're going to have to ball when you go to Cleveland or got Cleveland on your schedule. So I'm excited for that. I mean, Cincinnati, Baltimore, I mean, it's always a problem in that division, man. So, but through and through, hands down, always, you know, Steel City, 100%.
Well, I'm a big fan of your coach, Omar Epps. I'm sorry, Coach Tomlin.
He's stupid.
Does a great job. He does a great job for the Steelers over the years.
Yeah, so you jokes in there. That's cool. I see you shot down.
So Lamman, lastly, and I appreciate your time, as a big fan of this show, can you just give us a glimpse? Can you give us a hint of the relationship between you and Tasha Skanks on the program? What is going to occur here? What could we see throughout the season?
Man, you know what? I might not can't tell you everything I'd like to tell you, but what I can say is that some things are going to surprise you. So you might think you know what's getting ready to happen, but some things might surprise you. I think one of the things that we try to flirt with on this show is what people's intentions really are, and then what their loyalties really are. And the fact is, every character on here has these conflicts between what it is they are supposed to do or what somebody else is telling them they're supposed to do, and yet what somebody else is telling them they're supposed to do, and then yet what their conscience, right, is telling them they should or shouldn't do. And we all have our weaknesses and frailties and temptations and desires and pain, but yet, you know, we've also, you know, but none of us are stupid, right? So you're going to see some things, I think, that are going to surprise you, but it's you can definitely see Tasha and Jacob starting to, you know, that there's some sparks that are starting to kind of germinate between them, and where they go is going to be, you know, interesting. And it's going to be tough. It's tough when both of these people don't seem to really have the love and support or the presence that they really require of their spouses, even though Carissa's right there with Jacob, she's not really there. He doesn't really feel like she's there for him. And then physically, she's not there for him because she's also doing so many other things. And now that they've got this issue of their daughter kind of creating kind of a split, you know, within the marriage as well, and how they should raise her and what she needs and what's best for her, blah, 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 blah. It just gets even tougher. She's not there to help out in the fulfill her role as the first lady, and Tasha's there to fill the void. So it just creates a backdrop and a circumstance where, a lot can happen with Jacob and Tasha. And some things are going to happen. There's some things that are going to go down. But, you know, who knows exactly how deep that in that rabbit hole they're going to fall. And then again, we haven't seen Basie. So, you know, when does he come back into the conversation? You know, it's not necessarily just a Carissa, Jacob, Tasha triangle. At some point, you know, we still don't know where Basie is and how and where he fits back in to the story or into the equation at some point. So it's going to be interesting. I mean, if you pay attention, I want you to definitely pay attention to whenever you see Tasha come in that office, whenever comes in Jacob's office, pay attention to the little things. That's all I'm going to say. And that'll start to give you some hints about what's going on. You know, things that are said, the things that she asks him to do, and then so some of the nuance between their, between the two of them and their interactions, you know, with each other. I mean, you know, they're just co-workers who, you know, enjoy each other's company. But yet, at the same time, there's some other things that are happening. You'll see at some point, you know, it's all going to come out. At some point, it's all going to come out. But it's another interesting storyline, and we had some interesting conversations about it as while we were shooting, and we had to make some really interesting decisions as we're going through it to make sure that you know, not only that we got that we were executing what the network wanted to get from the storyline, but so that we all felt that we were honoring the reality and the principles of these characters, you know, a certain way too. We didn't want to do anything that was just going to be, that really wasn't going to make sense, or that, you know, we thought was just going to be contrived, you know?
Yeah.
I think it's interesting. It's going to be fun. It's going to be fun to see how it all comes out, how it all gets edited together, and all that too. So, I'm excited about it.
Yeah, it all starts with a bright smile, the ties and offering sheet, and a tight skirt, and then it goes from there. Man, that's a
downhill from there. No doubt about it. It all goes downhill from there.
Lamont, I'm glad you spent some time on the show. I really appreciate it. It's a show that I'm a big fan of, so it's great to be able to talk Greenleaf.
My absolute pleasure. So thanks for having me with you, man. Continued success, and congratulations on, you know, on your long time in this business, man, and the incredible work that you've done, and your impact not only in Chicago but even now, you know, nationally as well, man. So it's great to continue to see you shine, and to hear your voice over the airwaves too, man. So continued blessings and success to you as well. Have me back anytime, man. We can even chop it up about sports and who knows what else, you know. Always here for you, man. So, like I said, continue blessings, and until the next time.
Lamont, thank you so much.
My man.
You're listening to Under the Hood Podcast with Jonathan Hood.
Great conversation with Lamman Rucker from the hit TV show Greenleaf. Again, you can go to Oprah.com. That's where you can find it. Oprah.com, and then look for all the shows that Oprah has on her network. I mean, it's Greenleaf. It's It's Ayanna Van Zant. She has a show on there, Love Is, which is a show that I'm starting to get into. Season one of that show, they have it, have nots, The Pains, Super Soul, whereas Oprah has a sit-down, long-form conversation. She talked to Tom Brady in season 8 of Super Soul. The only, really, one of the few times you see Tom Brady actually open up and talk about his life is with Oprah Winfrey. So Oprah's got it going on Oprah.com. You can check out that season of Greenleaf. I think that you'd really like it. All right, the executive producer of the Under the Hood podcast is Sean Davis. Great conversation with Lamman Rucker, the Steelers fan, and someone who really loves what he does as an actor. So we will talk to you again with another edition of the Under the Hood podcast.